Lame man walking, talking about Christ, the author and the finisher, the source of life. He paid the lost price, and that's why I'm in. It's not because of me that I'ma overcome sin. Yeah, I'ma win, your boy already won.
Hope everybody had a good Resurrection Sunday. Rejoicing in the fact that the Lord not only died, but he rose for us. And so, one of the things, right before we pray, we can take this into prayer with us. So as you went through this whole Lenten season, the season of preparing ourselves for the cross and the resurrection, what that means, think for a few minutes of what have you come out of Resurrection Sunday with? What's the dominant theme that's in your heart? What do you feel the Lord has impressed upon you during this time? What do you come away from the cross with? So no order, but as you feel led, speak on that. We'll kind of pray that into our Bible study start.
You can speak on.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, for me, this was a very, very important season for me going into this land. I really, really want to make a statement on how I appreciate what the Lord has done in my life, and I just wanted to give something of myself to for the Lord to know that I do put him first in all that I do. And what I learned in that season is that it don't matter. That's what I want.
Right. You know, it's good.
It's good.
Right.
And everything.
Right.
But what I learned was that his son Jesus Christ already did it.
Amen.
Already did everything.
Yeah.
And all I have to do is learn to trust him.
Yes, sir.
Begin to trust him and allow him to develop that trust in me. That I never knew, that I never felt, that I never understood. I can't even fathom. And in doing that, it's been a lot of stuff going on. But at the same time, that's where I understood that's how he brings you to trust him more.
Yep.
And so it's been a journey. It's a journey, and I look back. I can reflect all the way back to 1998. 1998 when I realized that's when I first got saved, because that's when I really did get saved. But I didn't know that.
Right, right.
And I done been through some stuff since then.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And through all that, when I look back on all that, coming out of this season right now, I can honestly say that I have a deeper trust and a deeper sense of trust in the Lord and knowing who the Lord is and how he operates my life. So it's good.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Good curse.
The season I'm in is I didn't learn to trust him. Mm-hmm. You know, I did, but had to start putting stuff aside later and take control of it. Again, as I told you, you know, about the vehicle, I had my mind set on something. And I just had to take a step back, and he put me in another direction. And I led a van even more than I would have probably led a car. I had choke issues with student loans. I just trusted him. Sent me letters yesterday saying, because at first they was talking about garnishing my Social Security. Mm-hmm. Sent me letters, done. They removed that order. It's just stuff with the kids. I decided, you know, to let him use me. So a lot of things in my life is just working out. Good job. That's in that season, just trusting him. And how he's working with me, you know, I love my music. You never guess what kind of CD I made the other day. CD of sermons. I just want to sit, listen to sermons on riding in the car, because he's bringing to that where I need him more. So now it's time to focus in on him. You know, I love my music. That was my desire. Baby, I just went back there and made a CD, you know, the different sermons. He's like, man, you and Sword and everybody. So
that's
I see him moving me, yeah.
Growing you to your desire being more for the things that relate to him in a deeper way.
So jumping out the driver's seat in the back seat.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Let him drive you around. That's a good way to travel, brother.
Oh, yeah, man.
We get to enjoy the view. You got to worry about making a left, making a right, or where I go next. Just taking in. That's a beautiful thing. Amen. Others, as you share, I'm reflecting.
I made a small sacrifice during Lent. And, you know, I thought it was really big because it was hard, you know, for me to make that sacrifice, but it allowed me to really see what a huge sacrifice he made for me.
Amen.
Just to feel the sting of that little small thing you feel.
Small thing was nothing.
Yeah.
You know, but still, it just enlightened, you know, that understanding.
Amen. Yeah, that brings it right where we live, where we can kind of, because he's saying in the scriptures, they that suffer with me, will reign with me. And I think that suffering is, it's a day-to-day living, like dying to my will and my desires to live to his, but it also rises up as he calls me to take different momentary sacrifices that lead me into, like, your whole life should be this. It may not be this thing you gotta sacrifice for all the time, but this is what your life should look like as you continue to walk with me. As big others, as you touch upon this season of where you are.
Well, you know, I got a
testimony. tell it.
Probably the last couple of years, I've been hunting for a job. And, I mean, God has truly sustained me beyond my recognition. Because my plan was I was not going to be in California. I was going to pack up and slip away.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord has just blessed me abundantly. And probably about, well, at the beginning of the year, I kept saying, you know, I need to step out in faith. I need to make a move. I'm ready for change. And I decided to remove myself from faith. And not because of what was happening at faith, but because I needed it. Because I knew that was not what God had in store for me.
For you.
That I knew he had something better in store for me. I didn't know what it was, but I knew I had to just step out on the water. And once I decided that I needed physically to move myself forward, he opened all doors. I got a job. I had 3 job offers since I got the first job, and 4 days since I got the first job. And it was like, he was saying, all I wanted, you said you believe in me and that you know I'm in charge. I wanted you to prove it to me that you believe in me.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I wanted you to show me that you can say it, but do you really believe it?
Walk it out.
Trust me. Do you really believe it?
Yeah.
And once I did, it was like.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Floodgates.
Floodgates.
Yeah.
They keep pouring.
Mm-hmm.
They keep coming.
Amen.
I didn't know how I was going to do anything, and he just keeps showing up.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I think about, oh my God, this is another roadblock, he just keep opening the door.
Amen. The conquering king.
So my testimony is, wait on the Lord.
Amen.
Just wait on the Lord.
Amen.
Not in your time, but in his time.
Amen.
Just wait on him.
Move when he say move.
And move when he say move.
That's it. Because what it sounds like you've experienced is part of what the scripture says, that he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to the power, watch this, that works in us. So it was the power of God's spirit that worked in you to bring you to a convincing moment of a moment of decision. Move. Like, so that was the power, according to that power. And then now that he has moved you by his spirit, now here comes exceedingly abundantly above, like, you know, it's not that you were so smart, so wise, but it was so impressed upon your heart that this, and see, this is beautiful because the Lord uses symbols. It wasn't really about the place you were at, right? The group, it was about your personal journey and the personal call that you, I'm talking to you, you move.
Yes.
No matter who say what and all this, so then you get the pressure of, well, what about you? Like, are you hearing me? Or are you paying attention to them?
Mm-hmm.
And to move at that is where God says, now, you have been brought to live out the measure of faith that I've poured in. And then there go them floodgates. Because then he honors his word by showing you that that was me. That wasn't a ghost run. That wasn't just a blank trip.
No.
That wasn't a move. And now what am I going to do now? Mm. He's like, I'm over here. I was over here waiting on.
And Larry, when I went for the job interview,
yeah.
I don't went for many job interviews, sure, I can tell you this, and I didn't hear nothing from the people.
Right.
I was in this lady's office 5 minutes, and she was wanting to know, how soon can you come to work? I said, tomorrow.
Let's get it.
She said, well, you know I have to get clearance to make sure you're not a criminal. So it takes a couple of days. But the next day, 2 days after that, I had an offer.
Lord don't
that was God. That was God.
Yes, it
was.
The Bible says he watches over his word to perform it. Mm-hmm. Right? He's actually like watching over the things he said, spoken to us. Listen to this. In his word, but then also the things he has personally spoken to us. This is why we got to pay attention. This is why we got to listen to his voice, because he's watching over those secret things he's told us that ain't in the Bible. They line up with the Bible. But they're not, there's no scripture verse on that per se, but it's a word to your personal and your personal story and journey. And then it says he's not lazy over what he wants to happen. He's not, well, whatever. No, he's watching over, he's connecting dots, he's up the road, making sure that at the right moment, at the right time, that word bears fruit. See, that's a faithful God. Mm-hmm. He don't just speak and then wait and hope. He speaks and then causes stuff to go his way.
This is a kind of small testimony, I guess, but yesterday I decided to go for a quick, I usually run around Lake Merritt. Then I decided to go for a run, but on a hiking trail. Mm-hmm. So I went to Redwoods Regional Park, first time there. And you know, I've been hiking before, so I figured, you know, I can navigate my way through. So I'm running. You know, before I started the run, I asked someone, okay, so what's the best way about to go? She said, oh, go make a right down, make a left down there, make a right there. I'm like, oh, it can't be so bad. So I'm running in Redwoods, and Redwoods is deep. Okay, so I'm in Redwoods, and before I know it, I'm like, did she say left, right? So I'm like, man, I don't know where I'm going. So I'm going deeper and deeper and deeper, and the trees are so big. I'm like, wait a minute, it's like 6 o'clock. I'm about to be out here.
Right. Pitch black.
Pitch black outside. Right. And nobody gonna know I'm here. My phone's in the car. I got no map.
Right.
And I'm being all arrogant about it. Like, I'm gonna be okay. And I can find my way.
Right.
But I'm in the woods. And I'm like, wait a minute. Like, Lord, right. I'm in the wilderness. Like, if I go this way, I'm going the wrong way.
Right.
And I keep going the wrong way.
Right.
And I'm running into the wrong direction. And I'm like, yo. So I literally get to a point where it was like left or right. And I did not know. I didn't know there was a wrong way. And then there's nobody around me. 30 seconds later, this old man's running. I'm like, yo, thank you, Lord.
Right.
All right? So the old man gives me directions. He says, just go this way. But I took those directions, but then later on, there was another.
Right.
You didn't say you Yeah. There was another
whole bit.
Yeah. So I'm like, well, which way do I go? The whole time I was running, nobody came. When I got to that fork, someone came.
Uh-huh.
Like, yeah, just go that way. I was like, Lord, like, he's just showing me, like, I got you.
Yeah.
I got you. I know you're going to be stranded here.
Yeah.
I got you. And it's just like, I felt the whole time I was running, some part of me was feeling like nervous, but the other part of me was like, nah, the Lord got me.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he kept showing me by people, through people,
showing
just pointing me in the right direction.
That's good.
Yeah. That was good. I can't even always tell her about it. I was like,
because the same thing happened, and I went with somebody who had went before. That way, we was going up, and around, and down, and then back up.
And you know how big those trees are, man.
It's scary.
But here's what I was just saying about, like, God is an amazing preacher, right? God knows how to proclaim in symbols and metaphors to preach really life messages through, seem like, this is odd, like, but he'll take you on the redwood hike, on your own, not knowing where to go next, and then send somebody as a way to comfort, like, this is me. Giving you signs of where I am in your real journey. This, like, at the moments when you get stuck, I'm gonna show up. Like, that's God intervening in a personal way. That ain't in the book.
No.
It line up with the book, though. But it's your personal experience, and God speaks through that to let you know he's with you.
But in a lot of the biblical stories, you'll see that somebody just shows up, and you don't know. It'll say a certain man.
It lines up.
And said they went that way.
Yes. It lines up.
And then that's a no-name person.
Yeah, yeah.
These no-name people that just came up with you and said, go that way.
They say if he take care of birds,
right?
He, man.
So I mean, because that is the message of the book. Jesus says, when I return to the earth, the thing he's looking for, he says, is will I find faith in the earth when I return? Will there be people trusting, relying, waiting, expecting? Like he says, this is the posture I'm trying to develop, which is why he lets life be life. Ups, downs, good, bad. He's not going to give us perfect circumstances because else we'll rest in our circumstances. But he gives us this perfect relationship that he avails himself to be present in every situation so that we can, listen to this, trust him. I don't trust circumstances. I don't trust this job or that. All of those are just channels, resources, but he is my source.
Yes.
He will be present. And so he can sustain you, Sister Deborah, without a job for some years, and then he can step up and make somebody give you the job before you've been in there 10, 15 minutes when it's time for a new channel. But he's saying, I want you to be clear. I'm the source, though. Everything flows through me. And so that's what God is after. Anybody else, in terms of the season you're at as we come out of Easter Sunday, we're just kind of reflecting on, you know, what God has been doing in our own individual journeys. Cool. Well, we're going to pray, but I do want to at least, I'm going to share mine. The thing for me that landed this year was a greater weight on Jesus actually died. Like, sometimes we run so quick to Sunday, resurrection, and that's the reality of our story. But I was brought to this place to really reflect on where the disciples were when Friday happened.
That's right.
It was like, we've been out here with this cat for 3.5 years. It ain't supposed to end like this. Like, he actually, the tomb is closed. It's a wrap. Like, that landed on, we had a Good Friday service here, and this was very different from the traditional Good Friday services I've been to. We go to the Good Friday service and preach the last 7 words, and we are mixing Friday with Sunday. And so we're both, he died, but we know he rose, so we're still in full celebration. We don't let the weight of, no, hold on a second, stop. He died. Nothing happened on Saturday.
Right.
It was a confusing and dark day. The disciples was packing up tents. They was ready to go back to the fishing game. Like, they didn't know what to do. The guy we've been putting all our hopes on as the Messiah has been removed.
Yeah, for real.
I don't know what I'm gonna do now. All my hopes was on him, and so that weight, so at this Good Friday service, we read the narrative of Jesus up to the cross all the way to the time of him being put in the tomb, and they rolled a stone and it's final. And we left the sanctuary at that moment in darkness, in silence, in not happy-go-lucky, and think about that for a minute. Like, he's in the tomb right now. Like, it's all the hope of the world is been closed in on, and it's a bad day right now.
That's right.
So, like, that, like, he actually went through with it. And to know that he had all the power he needed to stop this from happening, and to know he was absolutely innocent, but he kept his mouth closed when they railed him with all the accusations. But he was doing all of that for us. Like, he actually fully went, he let himself, listen to this, be put to death. We're not going to let nobody walk up on us and just we're not going
to
just let it. I mean, you might get away, but I'm going down with a fight, brother. Like, but he didn't see. He said nothing. And so he stayed in his godness in terms of who he was. He didn't shrink from that. But he really lived in our place and assumed the guilt that was upon us. And he was was put to death like that man. So when I got to Sunday, it was a different Easter Sunday for me. It was like, I'm thinking, what are the disciples thinking on Sunday? Because he was actually dead, and now I see him. Mm-hmm. He's actually like, this is what made them cats be ready to get killed. I'll die for the gospel now, because like, I saw him be put to death, and I saw him raised up. Mm-hmm. I saw the nail, like, this is real. So they was like, let's go then. You can do whatever you want to me. I know that Christ is real. So like, I just believe from that Friday to that Sunday, that's an amazing gap. An amazing experience of, no, this is not happening. Oh, it did happen. Man, what am I going to do now? What about all the stuff he said? Was that true? I thought he was supposed to be, well, like confusion to now, like, man, he is risen. Like, the Lord is back. Like, and so I just think that is to live in the light of that resurrection power, to live in light of the Lord who has conquered death, the heaviest thing that stands before me, and know he has gone through that on my behalf and that he had carried. So now he's saying, all right, Larry, then just go ahead and live, man. Go ahead and you don't have to be worried about death and not like, I've already answered that big question. Let's move forward. So that's kind of what the Lord impressed upon me. Like, he actually, God died for us.
Yes.
Like, that's big. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this season, this journey to the cross, this re-education, and the great work that you accomplished for us. Outside of all of the stuff that we do and the services that we render unto your name for the glory of the gospel, the weight of our story is not in what we do for you. The weight of our story is in what you've done for us. And so, Father, we thank you for calling us as individuals and intertwining us into your story, your movement towards the glory of your name. And Father, we pray that as we continue to walk in this new season, in this new remembrance of your great work on our behalf, that Father, you would deepen in us the things that you're looking for. And mainly the thing that even rose up in all of our testimonies was this trusting in you, this faith, this reliance, this dependence. As we live life and we get ourselves in blind spots and spots where we can't see what the next step is or see which route we're to go, that Father, you will show up and you will guide us, you will counsel us with your eye upon us, God, and you are watching over the words you have spoken over us and in us to bring those to pass. And so, Father, as we sharpen our ears that we would hear you more clearly, that we would walk with you, with a greater cadence and a greater confidence, doing the things you called us to do. Pray for us as we gather together to get in your word. And for these few minutes, God, would you speak to us, and would you deepen that faith, that trusting posture as we look in your word tonight, God? Would you stretch us so that we would have more capacity to rely upon you? This is our hope and our prayer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank you. So we are, I want to do a quick recap. We've been on this Pilgrim's Progress. We have this sheet that we've been doing the last couple of weeks better, at least trying to get to this sheet better than. And it rose out of this conversation that Christian was having with Pliable, and who's the other brother name? Pliable and Obstinate, tried to track him down and get him to turn around. So let's do this. I want to start on page 10. I want to reread up to the point where Pliable makes this statement that's in our better than packet. So we can look at page 10. That's in this first stage sheet. I gave you a Pilgrim Progress. It says part one, first stage. So we can look on page 10, which is our front page, right at the third paragraph towards the bottom where it says, now I saw. Mm-hmm. Yes. It says, now I saw upon a time. So I'll begin reading there. Everybody have one? Good? Okay, so I'll begin reading there, and then I also maybe have a couple folks be those characters. So when we get to the story, if somebody could be Christian for us, somebody wouldn't mind being Christian, and somebody also can somebody be Pliable?
I'm a Christian.
Okay, so Sean be Christian. Can somebody be Obstinate? Okay, so Deborah be Obstinate, and then so who said Pliable?
I'll be Pliable.
Okay, cool, thank you. So when we get there, you guys will take over reading, And so here we go from page 10, Pilgrim's Progress is the story this is. So it says, now saw upon a time when Pilgrim was walking in the fields, that he was, as he often did, was reading in his book, and greatly distressed in his mind. And as he read, he burst out, as he had done before, crying, what shall I do to be saved? I also saw that he looked this way and that way, as if he would run. Yet he stood still, because as I perceived, he could not tell which way to go. He looked then and saw a man named Evangelist coming to him, and he asked, basically, why are you crying? And he answered, sir, I perceive by the book in my hand that I am condemned to die, and after that to come to judgment. And I find that I am not willing to do the first, nor able to do the second. Okay, so it's like he was in the redwoods, brother. He was stuck. Which way do I go? And then it says, then said Evangelist, why are you not willing to die, since this life is attended with so many evils? The man answered, because I fear that this burden that is upon my back will sink me lower than the grave, and I shall fall into Tophet, which Tophet means hell. And sir, if I be not fit to go to prison, I am not fit to go to judgment, and from there to execution. And the thoughts of these things make me cry. Then said Evangelist, if this is your condition, why are you standing still? He answered, because I don't know which way to go. Then he gave him a parchment roll, and there was written within, fly from the wrath to come. The man therefore read it, and looking upon Evangelist very carefully, said, where must I fly? Then said Evangelist, pointing with his finger over a very wide field, do you see yonder wicket gate? The man said, no. Now remember, the wicket gate is, narrow is the path that leads to life, and broad is the path that leads to destruction. He says, do you see that narrow path? And the man said, no. Then he says, do you see yonder shining light? And that scripture is basically, word is a light unto my pathway, a lamp unto my feet. And then he says, I think I do. Then said Evangelist, keep that light in your eye and go directly there. So you shall see the gate, at which when you knock, it will be told what you should do. So I saw in my dream that the man began to run. Now he had not run far from his own door when his wife and children, perceiving it, began to cry after him to return. But the man put his finger in his ears and ran on crying, life, life, eternal life. So he looked not behind him, but fled towards the middle of the plain. The neighbors also came out to see him run. And as he ran, some mocked, others threatened, and some cried after him to return. And among those that did so, there were two that were resolved to fetch him back by force. The name of the one was Obstinate, and the name of the other Pliant. Now by the time that the man had got a good distance from them, but however, they were resolved to pursue him, which they did, and in a little time they overtook him. Then said the man, neighbors, why have you come? And they said, to persuade you to go back with us. But he said, that can by no means be. For you dwell, he said, in the city of destruction, the place also where I was born. I see it to be so, and dying there, sooner or later, you will sink lower than the grave into a place that burns with fire and brimstone. Be content, good neighbors, and go along with me. I love that line. This can by no means be.
It ain't gonna happen.
Okay, so now we're at the story. And if we could pick up Obstinate, can go ahead and get us started.
What said Obstinate? And leave our friends and our comforts behind us?
Yes. Because that all which you forsake is not worthy to be compared with a little of that I am seeking to enjoy. And if you will go along with me and hold it, you shall fare as I myself. For there where I go is enough and to spare. Come away and prove my word.
What are the things you seek, since you leave all the world to find them?
I seek an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away. And it is laid up in heaven, and safe there, to be bestowed at the time appointed on them that diligently seek it. Read it so, if you will, in my book.
Church, said Athena, away with your book. Will you go back with us or not?
No, not I. Or was that me? Yeah. No, not I, said the other. Is that me?
Yep, that's you.
Okay. Because I have laid my hand to the plow.
Come then, neighbor, plowable. Let us turn again and go home without him. There is a company of crazy-headed cuckcombs that when they take a fancy by the end, they are wiser in their own eyes than seven men that can render a reason.
Then said Pliable, don't revive. If what the good Christian says is true, the things he looks after are better than ours. My heart inclines to go with my neighbor.
So let's stop right there, because I think that's the point we wanted to get to. That statement that Pliable, who's listening to this conversation between Christian and an obstinate who was trying to take him back by force to the city of destruction, and he hears this hope in the place that Christian has found. He hasn't arrived there, but the book has proclaimed to him a place that rescues, that delivers him, that gives him all of the stuff he's longed for, that the city he's lived in for all of this time cannot provide. And so hope is being built up and plied when he says, maybe what he's seeking is better than the stuff that we're seeking.
That's right.
So this word better than is part of the Christian journey. God has to go through a process to convince us that what he's calling us to is better than anything else that we can try to hold on to or create for ourselves. And so better than is a thing that has to happen first by faith. God don't show up sugar daddy in us out, right? Like, he don't just come with gifts. He go, a whole bunch of stuff, let me buy you. He like. Lame man walking, talking about Christ, the author and the finisher, source of life. He paid the lost price, and that's why I'm in. It's not because of me that I'ma overcome sin. Yeah, I'ma win, your boy already won. The glory goes to God, who spared not his son. Some of us gon' fly away, others will be left. Cause Christ took the fear and the sting out of death. Step by step, level of faith by faith. Like main attract said, man, it's only by grace. I seen God's face as the word was preached. Christ was his image, I was prostrate at his feet. I made